My love for photography began by wanting to create a feeling, a mood, an emotion from a single image without the need for words. To capture the world through our own eyes is a gift, for what we see is what we are. I've always craved adventure. So when I was 20, I bought a one-way ticket to New Zealand, where I worked as a photographer. I used to drive through Wellington on my way to work, and from several blocks away, you could smell this incredible aroma from the independent coffee roasters preparing their beans. I wanted to learn how to make coffee like I was served in the cafes in the city, so I did. I had no idea how much went into making coffee. But learning each of the individual elements that make a good cut is very much like the process of learning how to create a great photograph. Once you learn how to create depth, how to create movement or freeze the action, and how to draw your viewer into the scene, you'll realise that great photographs rarely happen by accident. You decide from the scene that stands before you what it is that you want to capture and what story you want to tell through your photograph. You know, I still remember my first camera. I remember who gave it to me. Thing is, I couldn't paint or draw to save my life, but photography seemed like the obvious way for me to express myself creatively. And although the technology has advanced and it's moved on, essentially it's still the same. It starts with a box. Light still comes in, records your image, and creates your memory. The most common question people must ask themselves when they're first starting out is, what camera do I buy? And the thing is, I don't think there's any real specific answer because it depends on a number of things. It depends on the individual, it depends on your needs, it depends on what you want to shoot. So I don't think you can be that specific. It can be a little intimidating because you've got all these buttons and dials and things that, you know, you're not really sure what they do at this stage, but to be honest, this camera is 100 years old, and I love the simplicity of it. It's a box, and it lets light in, records the image, and you can control it, and your film goes in the back. I know for a fact this would have produced some amazing portraits during its lifetime. Things move on a little, and we take this one. See, this one feels to me more like my first camera. It's got like a metal body. But things moved on. You can see now the lens is on the front. We've got the bellows. And you've got a little aperture ring around here. And you know, you've got more control. You can see things a little better. So this one's moved on a little from here. But it's still so cool and so basic. And I really like that about that one. So this one. This now is getting into the territory of what we're used to. This now feels like your shutter hand will go here. You hold this up to your eye, you've got a viewfinder. It's made of plastic as well, so that just shows you how everything has evolved over time and how accessible that became. This is much lighter as well, so this really changed things. I imagine this was really popular for family photography. And then we've got my latest edition. Well, of course, the biggest difference here is that this is digital. So all of these were manual cameras, and my first camera was a manual camera, and I don't think that was such a bad thing because it made you learn how to create a decent exposure manually. These have little computers inside them now, and they're there to aid you. Of course, you might want to learn how to control everything manually, which is great, But there is nothing wrong with using these auto settings or semi-automatic settings to help you get on your way. You want to be able to walk before you can run, and that's what they're there for. So I would say, when it comes to choosing a camera, don't get too hung up on the box. I do remember the excitement that you used to have when you shot a roll of film. Now, back in the olden days, when I was first learning, we used film. And what I really used to like was the excitement of being in the darkroom. It meant chemicals, it meant red lights, it meant just laborious, careful work. Once you were over the scary part of, oh, my chemicals mixed right, did I load it onto the spiral okay, did I do this, did I do that? The image would be projected down onto the paper in the dark room. Of course, in the dark room, you're all by red light, so you can't really see very much at all. And you take your paper over and you put it in the first tray and you start to see your image appear. And that reveal was really cool. It was really exciting. And I will still do that occasionally, just for that kind of buzz and nostalgia and, you know, that other little part of me that it takes me back to when I was at college and when I was first starting, and that sort of wonder of how did I do? Did this image come out all right? Is what was in my head gonna appear on the paper? And I love that. That was really exciting. So it's still fun to shoot on film every now and again. The advancement in technology has created a dramatic change in how we record our images. Of course, now everything is digital. This is a tiny little compact flash card, but your camera might take an SD card. Just look it up in your manual. It will tell you which one your particular camera will take. This is an 8GB card. So what does that mean? Well, on my camera, the file size, if I was shooting in JPEG mode, I could get about 1,000 files on here. If I was shooting on RAW files generally take up four times as much space, so I'll probably get about 250. But not only that, these are reusable. The beauty of these things is that you can shoot over them time and time again. So all you have to do is just make sure that you've downloaded your images, that's crucial. Download your images and store them correctly. Once they're backed up, you can clear this and start again. Now, the size of the card that you choose is completely up to you. For me, 8GB works quite well because typically in a portrait session, I might fill one of these, possibly 1.5. Memory is getting cheaper all of the time, so it can be tempting to buy a bigger card, say for instance a 32GB card, which means you only have to take one out with you. You don't have to worry about any others, and you can just fit thousands and thousands of images on there. And that's tempting. If you're shooting an event, say if you were shooting a wedding, and one of these cards went wrong, or you lost one, dropped one, damaged one, and you shot on a 32GB, 16GB card, and all of your pictures from that day are on this card, and you lost it, you got a bit of a problem. So you might find that if you're shooting in different places or different events, big events, just for safety's sake, you might want to shoot on smaller cards and have several of them. That way you know that should anything dreadful happen, your images are spread out over several cards and you're fairly safe. When choosing file types, where do you start? Well, we have a choice. We can ask the camera to take the data, compress and process that into a file called a JPEG. This means that the software within our camera is making its own summary of that data that was collected, and it creates an image of how it thinks we would like our image to look. Or we can ask the camera to collect the full range of data available and leave it uncompressed, so that we can make adjustments later on to get our image exactly how we want it. This uncompressed format is called a RAW file.
A RAW file is the equivalent of what was your negative. We used to do all of these things in the darkroom, making all these adjustments. You would tweak and develop the images for hours until it was exactly how you wanted it. So a RAW file is just doing the same thing, but on a computer instead. I like to go and photograph the surface. And of course they are moving so quickly, they're in and out of the waves and anything can happen. So most of the time I sort of follow one surfer in particular. And if I'm lining my shot up and they're just in right in the thick of the action, and I've set everything, everything's perfect, and a cloud comes over and changes my light completely, my shot is gonna be underexposed, but I'm not gonna change anything because I'm gonna miss the action. So I'll just shoot that anyway and freeze my image and get what I wanted, knowing that because I've shot raw, there are a few adjustments that I can make just to pull it back to how it should have been before that cloud came over and ruined my exposure. Of course, I could still make adjustments with a JPEG, but it just doesn't have the same range. The shadows and the highlights, it doesn't capture as much detail because your camera's already decided what it thinks is best for that scene. So whilst you could bring it back a little, it's not gonna look anywhere near as good as the RAW file will. I know a lot of photographers on a professional level who are always shooting high volume. So they choose to shoot JPEG because they just don't have the time to process all of those individual files. Personally, I still shoot RAW and JPEG. There is a function on your camera that allows you to do this. The reason being is because it's a kind of backup for me in one respect, that should anything go wrong or any files get lost, then I still have a RAW equivalent or a JPEG equivalent. But the real reason that I do it is because sometimes I can look through my JPEGs quite quickly to review my shoot and see what I got. And then I can go and look at the JPEG number and go and find the RAW file equivalent for that file. So if I decide that I really like this image and I want to enlarge it to 60 by 40 inches and put it on my wall, I've got the freedom there with the RAW file to make just tiny adjustments to ensure that when it is that size, everything is exactly how I wanted it. My recommendation to you would be to try and find the mode within your camera which allows you to shoot RAW and JPEG. This way you are able to review your JPEGs quite quickly, but just in case you want to explore a little deeper, you've got those RAW files there as well. So now you know all of the options that are available to you. Just get out there and shoot. You can try anything in all kinds of scenarios and just know that you've got that freedom there to explore, keep shooting, and just see what you get.